Hi, I'm Terry Murphy, the founder of the Women's Wisdom Network, the senior editor for Realty Times, Women in Business, Women in Real Estate, and In the Men's Room with Murph. And today we have an exquisitely wonderful, beautiful person in Women in Real Estate. I am her biggest fan next to all of her children and assorted other grandchildren and things. Her name is Tammy Slay. She is a fierce native Texan, Frisco, Texas. She owns and manages two real estate companies. She has earned the GRI, CRS, and SRS designations. She's basically an overachiever since I've met her. And I'm so glad to have her here today because we need a specialist, Miss Tammy, on how you've built a team from zero and using huddles as one of the secret elements of your success. Welcome us today.
Thank you. I am excited and honored to be here. And I could just sit here and listen to you introduce me every day of the week. That was fabulous.
I have to tell you though, okay, all of you listening. So if you ever wanted to bottle sunshine, this would be it. Okay. Miss America smile, Miss America everything. It's hard to love her, but really what's really amazing about her is her ability to galvanize people and with her enthusiasm, which is totally transparent. It's sort of like a puppy. It's just exciting to watch. Tammy's a mother of four children, in case you were wondering that, you know, that just comes naturally. Dog owner, multi-million dollar producer, team leader, entrepreneur, community volunteer, the 7-year awardee of the 5-star professional award. That's amazing.
Thank you.
And I've watched your growth with Workman Success as a coach. I'm impressed, mostly because you've taken Workman Success and you've Tammyized it. Seriously. And it's one thing to learn something. It's another thing to transform it. And one of the elements that you're particularly good at, besides RAMP, which tell us a little bit about RAMP, because those of us who are not familiar will not know what I'm talking about.
So RAMP stands for Rising Agent Mastery Program. And it is a program that was developed through the wisdom of the Workman Success crowd and taking a ton of wisdom and creating an entire 3-month program out of it. So I do lead a RAMP live program and we meet weekly with me live. And then I give assignments Monday through Friday, homework assignments that lead agents in production. The entire goal of this is to build the habits and the systems and the behaviors necessary over about 13 weeks together through high accountability and high participation and through a lot of fun, a lot of learning, a lot of growth. And we average about 30 to 40 people that are very intense in the program. And we partner them up with accountability partners. They get coaching from me weekly and coaching from my team weekly and throughout. So it's a dynamic program that has produced some really amazing results.
And originally, Workman developed it for onboarding new agents. And the fact is that even agents that have been in the business 10, 15 years are relearning dollar productive activities because real estate, as I like to say, is a shock collar business. You know, I mean, somebody shows up and your whole day goes. I want everybody to hear is how you've been able to establish community. This is virtual. This is all virtually. And if you study virtual engagement, it's a lot tougher because we're not in the physical. You've done that exquisitely well with people all over the country. And part of that, I think, is your early training on galvanizing your own team with huddles. Now, that is actually a byproduct of the younger generation because they didn't want to sit through boring, stupid meetings.
I don't want to sit through boring, stupid meetings.
Well, did I say that out loud? I did. And so what we discovered was that what could be done standing up in 15 minutes did not replace a meeting, but was an augmentation of community and exchange and conversation. Tell us about huddles because you're one of the specialists at this.
Oh, thank you. So huddles is, I mean, in a sense, we know about huddles from football. We know about huddles from games. And so when we really study what the huddle was originally created for, it's about moving the ball. Whatever game you look at, and I'm going to use football as the analogy in there, but it's about moving the ball down the field. Every huddle isn't just to gather around the water cooler and you don't see these big football players gathering around going, who brought the Gatorade? How was your evening? They're getting together for very specific, very intense little mini meetings to talk about the game that they're participating in. And in real estate, that's the game we participate in. So the huddle is intended to move the ball down the field and get to the end goal. And when you really understand the purpose of it, and I talk a lot about purpose through really anything, when you really understand the purpose, you know how to execute it and you know how to perfect it. So the huddle for us and as a team, and it's been a transition from our very first huddle three and a half years ago to our huddles now. And that's come from also in football, you got to record your plays because then you got to go back and you got to review them. And we did record our huddles to see the patterns, to see where we were missing the key points or where we weren't fulfilling the purpose of our meeting. And where did we get sidetracked? What could help us to stay on task and stay focused? But our huddles are very productive now, and they're very focused, not around water cooler talk, but they're focused around production because everybody on the team, and since we're in real estate, we all know this, we have goals, we have dreams, we have things we want to accomplish. And I'm about, let's take that dream, let's strategize it, let's bring it down to the key task, and let's actually accomplish it. Let's not just keep it up in the cloud as a dream. Why not experience that dream? And that's what the huddle does, is it allows people to accomplish these dreams that otherwise they were just that. Just a dream.
I think that's one of the biggest issues in real estate because so many people go into any sales position of I've got to make sales. But what you do is you invest in the relationships with the individuals on the team so that there's a collective energy and focus to get them where they want to go, which gets the team where they want to go. And I think this is a good point to talk about the distinction between the huddles, which is, and I'd like to know more about what happens in a huddle. So you say moving the ball down the field. Tell me as an example what that would entail with a typical huddle that you do.
Okay, so one thing I do want to just touch on that you talked about, and that is connecting with the people and understanding and really getting to know your team members and what their goals are. So my mission statement, not my team's mission statement, my personal mission statement is inspiring others to become what they dream of becoming. You know, as I sit down and coach, and I'm sure you have too, Terry, where you hear team leaders say, well, my goal for this agent is this, or my goal for my admin staff is that. And that's not what I'm about. And that's not what my team's about. And that's not what our huddle is about. Our huddle is about their goals. And I just inspire the way so they can accomplish their goals. So, and the reason I brought that up is because when we go back to the purpose of a huddle, it's also, what is the position of the team members? To have defense out there leading an offensive huddle, it doesn't work that way. To have an owner of the football team out on the field leading an offensive huddle, it doesn't work that way. There's really a lot to learn when you study the true huddle when it comes to a football game.
So when you're in the huddle, you said it's where the team is. So are you saying that instead of saying, what are you working on? How are you doing with Mary and John? You're actually talking about if they were focusing on two transactions per month, where are they with those two transactions per month? I think we want to know more about the granular part of what's happening in that.
Okay. So we do have our daily morning huddle. That is our offensive huddle. That is a huddle with predetermined plays. So for example, if I have an agent who says, my big goal is to accomplish 24 transactions, sold transactions by the end of the year in order for me to pay for my kids' college tuition because they're graduating, then we build a plan together on how to get that agent there. They came up with the goal. What they rely on with me is to helping to see the plays in action and how they can get there. So we would establish prospecting hours. We would establish how many calls does it take to get an appointment for that agent? Really understanding their mechanics, their internal mechanics, allows us to build the plays that need to happen. So if we were to pull up their huddle on a Tuesday morning, I can see that every Tuesday they have already pre-established, based upon our discussion in the plays, that they're going to do 1 hour prospecting, that they're also going to send 5 thank you notes.
And that already, and that ties into the My Planned Week, which says they're going to prospect on Tuesdays and Thursdays and whatever, and the Daily Success Habits Tracker, which is a tracker that we use to monitor and measure dollar productive activity. So 5 notes will get you 5 points. Again, you're gamifying it. I'll put that in there so that they feel the motivation and the moving forward part of that. Would that be accurate?
That would be very accurate. And the Daily Success Habit Tracker, it doesn't only just, it's not just a metric. It is a study in behavior. And every single agent has their own internal wavelength, their own internal prospecting conversion numbers. Every agent is different. Every admin is different. So when we track their behaviors, then we can understand how many hours they need to hit 24 transactions of prospecting. Are they better at door knocking than they are at calling? Are they better at calling FSBOs than they are at calling foreclosures? When we really look at the data, and yes, DSH is absolutely about metrics and tracking, but it's really more about the study into an individual's behavior.
I really love that, because with all of the discussion we've had about that over the years, no one's actually ever said that. We talk about creating habits, but habits are behaviors. Mm-hmm. And so thank you for making that distinction. Now, you talked about the daily huddles being offensive, and how long are they?
15 minutes at a max. We can usually, with our team of 9 to 10 attending, we can usually get done around the 10-minute mark. But ours, the team member that runs it, because it's not me that runs it, it's actually a sales staff team member, and we switch that out every year. But the team member that runs it knows that when it hits 15 minutes, she ends the Zoom call.
Done.
And everybody knows that. So we make sure, when we first implemented that, I was the last one to speak, and I got hung up on. It was really entertaining, because it was, well, now we need to hear from Tammy. Nope, it's 15 minutes. So we've made sure to allow time for everybody to speak. And so everybody takes a little bit of ownership in not having water cooler talk.
Okay, so if I was one of your agents, what would you be hearing from me?
If I were my sales staff member leading the huddle and I were asking you, I would say, because you told me yesterday what you were going to focus on yesterday, I would say, Terry, did you accomplish your 12 top 50 sphere prospecting calls? Did you do an hour of prospecting in the lead tracker? Did you also send the birthday cards for the week and get those in the mail? Because that's what you said you were going to do yesterday. Did it get done? And you would report back to me.
And if I was lame and said, well, my truck broke down and my dog died and, you know, there was a world war, what would be, so now I'm accountable to the team.
Mm-hmm. So then it would be, okay, do you recommit to it today? So there is a theme, and that is return, report, recommit, return, report, recommit. You're always establishing that when we get together, we're returning together as a team, we're reporting on what we did, and we're making a recommitment to the goals that we have already set in place through our annual strategic plan.
Now, y'all see why she's so good at this. Yes, she is. So let's talk about the meeting then. Do you have a meeting that's separate from the huddles that are daily, right? And they last 15 minutes and they happen on Zoom and they happen for what time in the morning, so that they know that
9 a.m.
So from 9 to 9:15 on their My Planned Week, blocked.
Blocked.
Absolutely red.
It's on everybody's Google calendar. It's there, and you know it. It's on there. Prospecting times as well are entered into the Google calendar. Anything that we've pre-selected for the entire 365 days of the year is already inputted into the Google calendar.
I heard that and I thought, oh my goodness, already blocked for the entire year. Mm-hmm. Well, as we'd say in the South, bless your heart. Now let's talk about that meeting. When is that?
Okay, so we do a team meeting. We do it on Mondays, and we do it at 9:30. That's a 45-minute meeting. We do have it blocked that just in case we have to go over into that hour, we can. But we try to really button it up at the 45-minute mark. And that's our weekly team meeting. So I would, if I were referring to that when we're looking at football, I would call that our pre-game huddle. And that's the one where it's motivational. That's the one where we talk about, what are we doing this week? What's our big goal that we're accomplishing this week? We do celebrations, birthdays, awards, who contracted on something? How did the weekend go? We have a team member that's over our culture connections, and whatever she has selected to enhance our culture, she has her time in the team meeting for that. So the team meeting is more motivational.
Okay, cult, that's brand new. I'm just going to confess, I've not heard that from you. Culture connection, what is that?
Culture connections, and it's on our huddle. That is a time that, excuse me, once a month or four times a month. However, Jamie, she's the agent that is running that for the team, but it's to unite the culture of the team. So in January, we focused on the book Rejection Proof, and then we went to Leverage. So all of our culture discussions were focused on learning from the book Rejection Proof, and also focused on what we learned from Leverage and what are we going to do with that information and make commitments. February, it's a course called Safe Conversations. So it's a course that teaches us how to have safe conversations with anyone in our life, whether that be a spouse, a partner, a friend, a client, a team member, but it's developed the habit, the behavior, and the routine to sit down and have safe conversations. And what does that flow in dialogue look like? So that's what we're focusing on for the month of February.
And where did these selections come from as a team leader?
They either come from Jamie, myself, or any team member that submits them. It's already built out for the entire year as to what we're focusing on every single month. Some things were things that stood out to us last year. For example, the Safe Conversations, that's a course that I took in November of last year, and I really enjoyed it. And I brought it to Jamie because she was assigned the Culture Connections for the year. And she looked into it.
Was that a book, or was it a course that people signed up for? Was it something from your church?
No, it was originally written by, it is kind of a book. It's actually a virtual course that you take. He wrote a book, Getting the Love You Want, Keeping the Love You Want. So it's a relationship based dialogue of discussions. And it sets you up so that way, when first, when you want to have a really important conversation, you ask for an appointment. So let's think about this working with a client. If I want to call a client to tell them that someone just terminated their contract, I'm calling the seller and to tell him contract's been terminated, I don't want to just blurt that out. They may not be in the right frame of mind or the right mood to hear that big information. And it's pretty impactful to hear that. So first is establishing an appointment, reaching out. I have something I would like to discuss with both you and your wife tonight. Are both of you available at 7 o'clock? If not, when is a better time that I can have both of yours attention?
Gotcha.
Rather than just shooting an email or a text or avoiding it, really owning up, setting an appointment, turning the phones off, looking at each other eye to eye. This isn't a phone call conversation. This is either we're sitting down one-to-one or we're getting on a Zoom, depending on how people are comfortable. And then opening it up with, I would like to tell you something. And explaining it, listening, and then repeating. So based upon what I'm hearing, what you're saying is, you would be more comfortable with this information if you knew why they terminated the contract. Is that correct? And then the seller would reply, yes, that's correct. Is there anything else I can provide or obtain for you to help you process this better? So it's developing the dialogue of setting the appointment, face-to-face eye contact, facing each other, no outside other distractions, and then gaining clarity and always ending with the question, is there more?
So again, it goes back to safe conversations. It goes mm-hmm. back to being intentional. It goes back to being personal, which is the honesty and the integrity and the perseverance. The perseverance on, by the way, that's the name of her company, HIP, when she started writing her core values. Yes. And so a lot of people write core values, and that's another whole segment, because I don't want to, I mean, that one, I want to expand on that, but yeah, HIP Realty. How do you like that? I mean, there's some real teeth behind mission statements and core values that they recite all the time and live it, I think, essentially. Mm-hmm. But what I'm hearing is that you actually are investing in the team's skill advancement, both personally and professionally, which speaks to loyalty. So I guess if I was listening to this and I was a team leader, I'd be like, how do you get them to show up? How do you get them to stay connected? How do you avoid the demotivation of going, I didn't get it done yesterday, I had a bad day, whatever. I mean, obviously that takes, that's some of your, what we call mama sleigh.
it is.
Mama sleigh is how they, how Frisco refers to Tammy Sleigh, but go ahead.
Okay, so you've probably heard me say this before, Terry, but my favorite scripture is, we love him because he first loved us. And there's so much wisdom in that scripture, whether you believe it or not, no matter what faith or non-faith you are, there's wisdom in those words. So how do I get my team to show up? I love them. And I'm not just saying that. I truly love them. In order for them to love me, I have to love them first. When your children are born, they're born with basic needs. They want to be warm, they want to be fed, and they want to be dry. And that's it. But the love that a parent has for a child starts long before the birth. And the child learns to love the parent because the parent initially loved the child. It's the same with our neighbors. It's the same with our top 50. It's the same with our team. People grow to love you after they know you love them. And when love comes safety. So at any time, any team member doesn't hit a goal or doesn't accomplish what they said they were going to do, they know I am okay with that. They have no fear of reporting that to me. They have no fear of saying it to each other on the team because it's a safe environment because we do truly love each other.
So it's a safe environment. It's not critical or judgment. It's and you tie it back to them. You said to me, your team leader, that you wanted to have 2 transactions per month so that you could pay for your children's college, whatever. So I like to refer, especially in coaching, as I'm Siri. You told me where you wanted to go. I'm telling you every day, turn right, turn left, go straight, yield over. I mean, when you do that instead of going, well, you wanted 24 transactions and you're not there yet, it provides that spotlight on the next step. Mm-hmm. And I think you do that brilliantly. And I've watched you in the RAMP program, which you completely, I don't know that Workman was prepared for that. You ran with that thing. Like, and how long is it? 16 weeks?
13 weeks with a kickoff, 14 weeks.
Yeah. I knew it was somewhere in there.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then the AMP is 16 weeks, I think.
Yes.
So the good news is that Tammy's going to have to join us again. Once you have a little Tammy, you got to have more Tammy time. I'm just going to tell you that because she's taken the basic tenets of coaching, leading, leadership. I'll say nurturing, because I think that in every leader, there has to be some nurture component to make people their best them, not a dollar productive team, which of course just is one of the results. And I want to thank you for joining us. If somebody wanted to contact you about the RAMP, do they have to be a Workman Success person?
No, they don't. Not at all. Just email me at Tammy, it's T-A-M-M-I-E, at WorkmanSuccessSystems.com. And watch the number of S's in there. Yeah. It's Workman Success Systems. So there's 3 S's in the middle.
I asked them 100 times, why couldn't we stop with just Workman Success? I mean, Right? Really, those S's, especially if you need glasses, gets confusing. Tammy, you know, I would love to do another segment. And for those of you that are with us, Tammy does a remarkable, and I want to say remarkable with every fiber in my body, way of supporting her local vendors by supporting her MVPs and her client, you know, just her clients in general, because she loves them all. But I must say that that has been impressive, especially during a time where small businesses have struggled. And I would encourage them to contact you for some of that consulting. And of course, coaching. And of course, if you have any referrals for HIP Realty in Frisco, Texas, give Tammy a call. Thanks for joining us. Promise us that you'll join us again.
Absolutely. Anytime, Terry. I love you.
I love you too. And you know what? Thanks for joining us on the Women's Wisdom Network. You need to stay tuned for another segment of Tammy Time, because she's coming back on demand. Thanks so much for joining us.